Hi everyone, welcome back to Vedic Life Coaching. Thank you so much for joining me. And welcome to the Sidereal Vedic Astrology Outlook for the month of October. Now, things are pretty hectic out there. The world is seeming to get busier, more chaotic. Things are going on out there. So I do have some things to talk about when it comes to news matchup. There are actually quite a lot of things going on at the moment. So I do have some things to talk about with the news. The other thing I also do want to look at is, why is it that individually many of us are feeling that it's stagnant? Isn't that incredible? We've got this phenomenon going on of, you know, for a lot of us individually, there's just not much going on. Why is that? I've got a bit of an astrological theory as to why that is so. Just quickly, I'll tell you, I believe it's Venus's prolonged stay in Cancer. We'll dive into that as a topic. You'll be able to, in the description below, I'm going to put little jump links. You'll be able to jump around into the bits that you want to see. So also in the mini reports this time, I'm not going to cover the new moon and the full moon because we're going to have two eclipses in October, and I will cover that in a separate breakout video for all signs. So stay tuned for that. Before I dive into the news and what's been going on lately, I just wanted to share a couple of links that have been just so good. One of you sent me an email, thank you so much to the kind viewer, who shared a link to a guy called BeerBiceps. I'm going to put up an image on the screen and I'll put the link below. Now the link is to an interview with Rajarshi Nandy, and he's just brilliant. I watched this video in full, I loved it. It's, I think, a couple of hours long, if I'm not mistaken. And basically he goes through the nine planets and the 12 houses of Vedic astrology. And if you're new to Vedic astrology, definitely watch that one video. It's like a crash course in the whole system. He will teach you all of astrology in 2 hours. It's pretty incredible. So definitely check that link out. I'm really excited to watch some of the other interviews with Rajarshi Nandy. I'm going to enjoy those. He's talked about Lord Shiva and Tantra and all kinds of incredible topics. I also saw on that BeerBiceps channel, what an odd name. Isn't that an odd name? I find that an odd name for a channel, but anyway, it's like an Englishman would call their channel BeerBiceps. But anyway, on that channel, he's also got a couple of good interviews, I do believe, with Dr. Robert Svoboda, and I'm quite excited to dip into those as well. I think they should be really good. I also wanted to share a link to an interview I did with Lisa Romero, and I haven't promoted this one yet on the channel. I've been meaning to. I think last month I didn't end up promoting it, but this month I want to promote it. It is the most recent Masters of Starlight interview that I did, and you'll definitely want to click on the jump link, The Work of Love. And if you click on that and just watch from there, you'll see this brilliant idea that Lisa has just about bringing love to wherever you are and whatever it is that you're doing. And that when you do that, when you bring love, for example, to your work, and I did this, I was in a job that I couldn't stand, and you know, I didn't like it, the boss didn't like me, there were all kinds of problems. Anyway, I brought love to the workplace and to him, just quietly, silently, you know, and I had quite a transformation happen quite quickly. It rapidly changed my situation at the time. And, you know, I could go into it. It's a long, boring story. I won't bore you with it. We have got so much to talk about. And what I want to get into is topic number one I've got here. Why have so many people been so exhausted lately? This is a big topic. And it's something that I myself have been experiencing. I was completely exhausted across the little heat wave that we had here in England. It really drained me. And that's because, you know, this place where I am right now, it's incredibly warm in the cold months. So it can be snowing outside and I might need just like half an hour of heating in the morning, or an hour max kind of thing. It will heat this whole place up and I don't need any more heat than that. It's just so toasty warm in here. And then in the summertime, it's a sun trap, and it's oppressive, and it's awful because there's just too much sunlight, and you know, it makes cooking difficult, and it's really hard to be in here in the summer months. Isn't that incredible? So across those really hot days, I actually was exhausted and I didn't do any work. I did do some work. I had a couple of readings. I did have some bookings and I did do some readings. But besides those readings, I really just couldn't find the energy to do any other work. So as a result, the archetype series, you know, I have delayed that a little bit. I haven't been putting out my usual output. And I've been searching for an astrological reason, and I think I have found one. The other thing, so I'm using me as an example here, but I've also got an example of one of my clients. One of you wrote to me an update, and it was so wonderful to hear from you, as it always is. I love hearing from my clients, no matter how long it's been. You know, you can always get in touch. And she got in touch. She's a real estate professional in the United States, and she let me know that her client pipeline had dried up, and it's been 3 months since she has sold a property. And you can imagine that's quite unusual in the United States across what would be the summertime. I mean, I could imagine that across winter people might have, you know, a couple of months where maybe they're not selling a house, but to have that happen across summer, I do think that must be quite unusual. So what is going on? And the other thing is that when I talk to people, either in sessions or friends of mine or just people I know, a lot of people individually are just feeling exhausted, they're feeling stagnant, they're feeling stuck, they're feeling no movement, they're feeling, what is going on here? Why is it like this? I totally understand. So all of this propelled me to look for an astrological answer. And I do believe it's Venus's prolonged stay in Cancer. We have here watery Venus in a watery sign for a very long time. Okay, so Venus's retrograde in Cancer has meant that Venus has been in Cancer for far longer. When Venus made her first pass through Cancer, right, when she just passes through Cancer the first time, it was 37 days. Then Venus is in Leo and dips back into Cancer. Now, this dipping back into Cancer is another 55 days. So that's 92 days of Venus in Cancer. That's a really long time. So, and I am thinking that this is the hallmark event of the year. This has been really big. And I think this is what has made it so stagnant. This is what corresponds to my client's update, where she says, for the last 3 months, I've had no activity. I've had no business, because we've had Venus in Cancer since 30th May. And I've been looking back at the monthlies I've been doing, and each monthly, you know how I come on here and I say, it's really quiet. And the next month I'll say, isn't it still unusually quiet? Do you think so? And a lot of you write in the comments and you go, yeah, it's been really quiet. And I've been saying that for the last 2 or 3 months, haven't I? I've been kind of saying, it's really quiet. What is going on? I really think it's this. Now, you might say that, well, hang on a minute. Venus was in Leo from the 7th of July to about the 7th of August. Okay, and that's about, I think I've got that here as 32 days long. That is true, but then Venus has been close to Mars for a lot of all of this. And that is quite interesting, because watery Venus has been dampening Mars, and Mars is our doing power. Mars is our ability to do, our action. You know, we get on with things and do things because of Mars. So this watery planet has been close to Mars. So I do think that Venus has been dampening Mars's spirit a bit. And as a result, the fact that Mars has been quite close to Venus across this whole time, and the fact that Venus has been in Cancer, watery planet in a watery sign, for 92 days, to me, that is the big explanation that I've got. And I started to have a look at people's charts and people I know, myself included. I've got Venus in a watery house in my chart. I've got Moon in a watery house in my chart as well. So I do think that that's actually what's making me sometimes I'm quite sluggish and slow, and I can't do the output. I can't, you know, get like the energy up. There are also other factors. If you look at where my Keith is, it's also I'm a human design projector. Human design projector, we don't have energy or much of it. Sometimes we have the illusion of energy, you know, and then we get all excited and then we burn out. So yeah, there are lots of different factors about these things. But I looked at my chart and I could see, yeah, I've got watery Venus in watery place and watery Moon in a watery house as well. Then I look at someone like Martha Stewart, and now she's a person who she work, she does work every day, like work all the time, you know. She sleeps 4 hours a night, and her energy and her output is phenomenal. I admire it so much, you know. I don't have a drop of that. I've got too many drops of water in my chart. That's what's, you know, making it not easy for me. You look at her chart, she's got her Venus and Moon in fire signs, and both are in air houses. So her two watery planets are nowhere near water, and that's what's making her watery planets quite a lot drier. And I think that that's what's making her ability to keep working so much and churning out lots of stuff and being prolific and all this incredible stuff. I think it's due to that. But the difference between me and her is that, like, you wouldn't want to take your broken heart to her, right? Because she's too busy doing lots all the time, and she'll just say, oh, come on, snap out of it or something. You know, such people, they may not be able to empathize. Whereas someone like me, no, you could really bring that problem to me, and I have got, you know, the time and the patience and the ability to take on that kind of thing. So, you know, that's one of the things that I observe here. A lot of you out there, a lot of my viewers, will have your watery planets in watery places. Or you'll have some kind of significant, you know, this is quite typical in an astrology audience. People will have like a significant 8th house, significant Scorpio or Pisces as well, actually. You know, you'll have, yeah, a lot of people who are attracted to and interested in astrology will have, you know, a 4th house as well, 4th house, 8th house, 12th house, or Cancer, Scorpio, Pisces, you'll have significant placements there. Anyway, that's my explanation as to why it is that some people, you know, even despite the conditions, if their watery planets are quite dry, despite the conditions, they'll be able to crack on and do lots of stuff. But me personally, if there's a lot of watery type stuff going on in the sky, I'm wiped out. I can't do much as well. So I can see an explanation definitely for me why things have been the way they've been. Now, one good thing is that Venus is going to leave Cancer finally on the 2nd of October. I think that this is going to bring a little bit of movement to us all. I do think so. Let's observe that. You can definitely write in the comments and let me know and tell me if this theory is true, or how you see this theory that I've got going on here. I've got the note here, Mars won't be close to Venus, and Mars is in a far drier place as well. So we're going to have Mars in Virgo, then Libra. This is good. I think we're going to see some forward momentum come 2nd October onwards. I'm certainly hoping that that's the case, because I've got so many projects and things. I was hoping to have a whole bank of content done while the Mercury retrograde was happening, but due to the heat here, it was really difficult for me to get any of that done. So I've got a lot of banked up projects that I want to make some progress on. Let's have a look here. Now, there have been predictions generally by a lot of different people and by a lot of different types of channels as well. I've been watching all kinds of different channels. Yes, astrology channels. I've seen some headlines. I haven't had time to watch the videos, but I've seen headlines of people talking about September. But equally, I've seen other types of channels, even finance channels, even, movie buff channels and all kinds of different channels. When you type in September predictions, everybody seems to be predicting things for September, saying that this is going to be a really huge month. A lot of people are saying be careful around 23rd September. I do agree that the energy is intense this month, and possibly take care on the 23rd of September. That is a prediction people are making. What I have seen is that the last few days of September and the early days of October, that could be quite intense. I can definitely see that. But I actually think I look at some of these September prediction videos and I do wonder a little bit, because some of the prediction videos that I've seen for September, they are coming from movie buffs. And what they're saying is that, you know how The Simpsons or popular films and things like that, they'll always flash these numbers. And it's like they're telling you, they're warning you of something ahead of time. And I know that in a lot of these movies, people are noticing, and The Simpsons and things like that, people are noticing the 23rd of September keeps coming up. So I'm not too sure about that. I sometimes wonder that, is it that the algorithms are pushing September predictions? I wonder that, because I tend to think, look, I've got here on my notes, the worst thing that could happen, I believe, has already happened. And I've been doing some digging into this. It was the fires that I didn't talk about yet. I didn't predict it and I didn't talk about it. This is the 8th August 2023, the fires. And I'm just going to say that we're on a small American island, okay? I'm not going to go too much into it, but what I want to say about that is I've had a look at it astrologically, and I've got here on the 8th of August, Venus was in Ashlesha Nakshatra, 29 degrees, 20 minutes of arc. Venus was, so basically Ashlesha Nakshatra, that is a very severe Gandhanta point. And I've been doing so many readings now, and to me, of all the three major Gandhanta points, Ashlesha is the worst. I've seen the worst of the worst stuff happen at the Ashlesha Nakshatra point. And we've got Venus here in that point, 29 degrees 20. So very severe, intense Gandhanta. Venus was retrograde. Venus was also combust. Now, normally I don't read combustion to be such a bad thing, especially when I'm doing a natal chart reading or something like that, because I see so many planets combust in the charts of massively successful people. I don't read combustion as a really bad thing, but definitely here with this transiting Venus, I am reading it as something that is severe and not good. If we take a look at Moon's position on this day, Moon was conjunct Jupiter in Bharani Nakshatra. Both are conjunct almost exactly. Bharani is lorded by Venus, okay? And Moon is in fiery Aries when we're looking as per the sun signs. And Rahu is in that house. Those of you who've been following me for many months, you'll know that I've talked about Rahu in Aries and that this is a time of fires. And I have covered the fact that egg factories have been on fire. We also have had train derailments and chemical plants and things like that, and chemicals, you know, on fire and mass pollution and all these kinds of problems. So across this period, up until, say, for example, end of November, yeah, we've still got Rahu in fiery Aries. And when I take a look at this date of 8th August, now I didn't predict it. I didn't say that anything bad was going to happen here. But when I look back now retrospectively, what I can tell you about this date is that the two most watery planets we have in the cabinet of nine planets, the two watery planets, to me they are looking like they are completely starved of water. We've got Venus, you know, in this really intense Gandhanta point. Venus is flanked by the Sun on one side and is moving into fiery Leo and is in the Gandhanta point. And of course, Venus is lording the moon's nakshatra as well. I've got the note here, there is no water on this day. So we can see that. And I've got the question here, was the activity man-made? And I've got here in the United States chart, it is possible to say yes to this question. Rahu, Moon and Jupiter are in the third house. Venus is in the sixth. Now, third house, we're looking at something that is, and this is third from the Moon. Third house, we can be looking at something that's man-made or hands-on effort. We can see that. Sixth house is Earth. I've got here the height of ego, the material world. And I've also got written here to me, this is the most devastating thing since September 2001. If we look at the chart of, you know, the big event that was September 2001, what you'll see there is you will see the same triple conjunction, Rahu, Moon and Jupiter, and you will also see Venus in Ashlesha Nakshatra. So I do feel that there is some similarity there. And to me, this, you know, this thing has been utterly heartbreaking, what has happened there. So yeah, if any of you are yet to hear from someone, I actually know one of you in the United States, and you were telling me that you're yet to hear from your person who is in that area. I just wanted to say my heart goes out to you. Light a candle for that person every day, and keep the hope strong. You know, you will connect with your person in some way. Hang in there. All right, that's what I wanted to say there. And before we get into the, oh, look at that, we're at the 22-minute mark. Before we get into the mini reports for this month, I just thought I would very quickly cover one of the other news stories that we have got going on. I don't think I'm going to timestamp this one. I will just keep it very low-key. This is just for the determined viewers who are still here at the 23-minute mark. For you guys, a little special bonus treat. I'm going to bring up the chart of, and I'm going to call him the English presenter. How about that? And I'll just check how we're doing on time. Yeah, this thing will cut out, but that's okay. I'll just start it again because at the 24-minute mark, it cuts out. All right, so let's take a look, shall we? Let's take a look at this chart. It is an interesting case study. It is kind of interesting to see what is going on here. Just from the outset, I just want to say that, you know, and I understand that this is a controversial topic, and I haven't watched the Channel 4 Dispatches thing as yet. If it appears on Rumble or something like that, I might watch it. I don't watch TV, even though I have one, but I told the TV licensing people I don't watch it, which is the truth. I never turn it on. I don't want to pay the fee. I think if I was to turn it on and somehow I logged onto that BBC iPlayer or something, they'll start sending me those awful letters again, like that you have to pay and all that stuff. And I don't want to pay for that because I don't watch it. But yeah, back to the chart. Oh, and I can see it's flashing red. Okay, we have got a fresh memory card. All good. Let's go. Let's take a look at this, and I won't take too long. I just realized this is really controversial, and I don't want anyone to be upset. So I hope I'm going to be able to just talk about this and not trigger anyone. I don't want to upset anyone. I believe the women. I believe that there are four women who've come out and they've said that, you know, this and this happened. As I said, I didn't watch the documentary, but I've read a couple of articles in the Times where the women explain exactly what happened. I do believe them. And, you know, at the same time, I have also watched the English presenter over many years, and I've seen him grow and change and transform. And I do think that in recent years anyway, he seems to have matured. He seems to be putting out good content for a side that is, you know, I mean, look at this. We've got four here. I've got a list of four YouTubers that are being cancelled and targeted in this month. I want to point you to Dr. Eric Berg. Dr. Eric Berg did a video where he's being silenced this month because of strict regulations. He might not be able to talk about, I think, the ketogenic diet or something like that. I mean, what is going on? You know, so it's interesting times here that we've got, you know, certain people are being silenced, and that is concerning. And obviously, look, I'm going to say this again, I definitely support the women. I think they're telling the truth, and I think it has to be dealt with. And, you know, that's really important. But at the same time, I do see that, and I'm going to call him the English presenter. I won't give his name because I don't want the YouTube thing to like tell me off. So there's all this censorship is going on, so I have to be careful as well. So yeah, the English presenter, like it's a difficult time, isn't it? And because I do think he has grown and changed, and I'll refer you to an interview by Andrew Sachs' granddaughter. If you type in Andrew Sachs' granddaughter, you'll see Piers Morgan is interviewing her, and I came to the same conclusion as she did. You'll see what she talks about. She says that she believes the four women. She definitely believes them, and she believes that, you know, justice has to take its course. And yes, I believe that too. She was badly treated by Russell, there we go, I'll just call him Russell, the English presenter. She was treated badly by him, but she did meet him in more recent times, and he was very apologetic in a sincere way. She said, I believed his apology. She said, I could see that he's grown and matured, and she believes he's a good man. And I think her interview was a really interesting one because, yeah, when I've looked at all these things, I've come to the conclusion that, yes, of course, I feel for the women and justice needs to happen. But at the same time, I do look at the English presenter and I think, wow, you know, this is a tough spot because, and what I would say, like, let's say, for example, if the women came to me for a coaching session, I would for sure help them. If the English presenter came to me for a coaching session, I would for sure help him. There are people I would decline, like Bill Gates or, you know, Klaus Schwab. I would decline those people. But if the people in this case study that I'm going to talk about, if they came to me for a session, I would help both sides. You know, and I think that's what the media has done to a lot of people. The media has kind of done this to people where if you say that you support the women, that means you automatically hate the English presenter. Or if you say that you support the English presenter, that means you automatically, you know, hate the women or something like that. No, that's not it. That's not the case at all. With the women, if they were to come to me for a session, I would say to them that it's also important that they look at, say, for example, a bigger picture, that perhaps, you know, they might want to deal direct with the English presenter rather than to go through the media. Because if they go through the media, they run the risk that their personal lives will be used in an argument that the media is having with the English presenter. And it's clear that there's an argument going on between the English presenter and the establishment. That argument has been going on for years, and I think they've allowed the English presenter to rise. They've allowed him to rise because they wanted the fall to be bigger, I think. I don't think the English presenter is controlled opposition, though there are debates about that on the internet. I think there's going to be a video someone is doing. I heard tomorrow they're going to launch something about, is he controlled opposition? I don't know. Look, there are so many things in here that I don't know. But let's take a look at, so you can see how I would advise the women that, you know, if they could look at the fact that, you know, they don't want their personal lives to be used in a bigger fight. But let's say, for example, they hear me say that and they go, no, I still want to proceed and go on this path. Then yes, absolutely, the women need to be supported in that. I understand that. But let's go to the English presenter now and let's just take a look at his chart and what would I advise there? Because I have the chart so I can see some things and I can say some things. So what would I see and say? All right, well, it's really interesting. He is, if we take a look firstly at the Dasha, Bhimshotri Dasha, we've got here that, I just closed that window, there we go. Bhimshotri Dasha is showing that he is at the end of his Sun Mahadasha. If we have a look at Sun is in the 10th house, okay? So he has got a prominent career, and this is a little bit of a king type thing, you know, Sun in the 10th, you are the leader, you are the king, you are you know, presenting or talking to a lot of people, or you have some kind of big career where you are seen. Okay, so that's Sun in the 10th. Now it's really interesting that the time period that he has just clicked into as of 6 September 2023, that is Sun Ketu. All right, now what does Ketu represent? Well, it's really interesting. Ketu represents the past. If I was reading this and I didn't know who it was and I had to predict about Sun Ketu, what would I say? I would be saying that something from your past life might surface at this time. Now, because I know the story and I know more and I can see what's happening, here's what I will tell you. We can see that Ketu is, so Ketu is sometimes a suppressing energy. Ketu acts in different ways. Ketu is fascinating. Sometimes it's suppressing, sometimes it's separation. All right. And this is really interesting because it's like he's being separated. We've got Sun Ketu in the Vimshotri Dasha. It's like a separation from his position in life. Okay. Separation from, you know, yeah, being the king, being in charge, being at the top. It could be seen as a fall as well. And I'm going to look at this because there will be a lot of high profile cases where the person has risen and they've had a huge fall. And I'm quite sure that it could be a Sun Ketu period that could do that to someone, especially with a combination like this in the 10th house. What we've got here, we could read that as a fall from a height. The other thing that we've got here is that, gosh, there are a few things. He started Sarisati in Jan 2023. So we know that things are going to be tough now for about 7 years. It's going to be difficult. It's like Saturn wants him to deal with his past karmas now. And that's really interesting. Sun, conjunct Ketu. Ketu is past. Now I said past lives, but what's really interesting in this case of this English presenter is that this is not past life karma that's coming up. It's this life's karma that is coming up. And it's specifically in relation to love life. which we've got Ketu lorded by Venus. Venus is seated here in the 12th house. Another thing that's really interesting is he's at the very end of the Sun Mahadasha, which means there's a bit of Dasha Sandhi period going on. He's getting a taste of Moon Mahadasha now. And I think Moon Mahadasha could be very isolating for him. Moon is lording this Venus here, right? So this is quite interesting. Because the 12th house, when we look at the 12th house where Venus sits, that's also prison. So it's kind of like the past of his love life could put him in prison. That is a possibility here. I've also just been talking about the fact that Venus in a watery place is, there's not much activity. You know, if you watch the introduction where I talked about, you know, why is everything so slow? Why is everything so stagnant? Basically his Moon Mahadasha, I don't see that this, look, this the Moon Mahadasha could be okay because the Moon is in Viprit Raj Yoga. And what I say to my clients who've got a Viprit Raj Yoga is that it's kind of like you have to do battle with a monster and then there's a pot of gold behind. You know, like Viprit Raj Yoga can be really challenging, can be really difficult, but you can turn it into something magnificent. But it's not without pain. So, and in some of the videos I've been watching on YouTube, people are saying things like, well, he could sue the media and he could get a lot of money. So that is a possibility. It's not out of the question here because that moon is in a Viprit Raj Yoga. But what we can definitely see and say, I do think that from here on until about January 2025, I think life's going to be really quiet for him. I don't think we're going to see much of him at all. I don't think he's going to be able to post anything on YouTube. I don't think he's going to be able to do very much. And yeah, I have so many notes here. But I've also got a flashing battery there. Oh, and it's 13 minutes. I didn't want to spend too long on this. What I'm going to do is I'm going to change the battery. And then I'll kind of try and wrap this up quickly. Hi, everyone. Apologies about that. I'm just kind of looking at my notes here. The other thing is that he's 48 years old, so Ketu is maturing at this time. And see, this is one of the things I would advise. If he was my client, I would be advising that it's better to be a quiet, private individual. He's got Rahu in Scorpio in the fourth house. It's better to be a quiet, private individual than to be doing what he really wants to do. He's got Ketu in the 10th house. He really wants a big career. His comfort zone is a big career. He wants to be on a stage. He wants a lot of people in front of him and succeeding and all that kind of thing. He can't get enough of that stuff. He wants to keep doing that. But from what I see in these charts, that's not going to be good for him. What's going to be good for him is if he let's go of all of that. And this is really a time of letting go. This is Sun Ketu period. Ketu, let go, surrender. You will have to. If you resist the flow, it will be painful. We can see that, you know. And so that's what's going to be interesting going forward. If he can be really calm, go with this flow, really let go, really surrender. If he can really do that well, then he can possibly have a nice life, an okay life or whatever. I don't know. I don't know what's the right thing here. It's not for me to decide, but he can have things more on his terms. But if he really resists and fights and goes hard and, you know, that could land him, as I say, yes, in prison. That's a possibility with the Venus here in the 12th, because Moon Mahadasha, Moon is lording this 12th house, and it's like his love life could have put him in here, if you know what I mean. Venus is in the 12th. Yeah, time will tell. Look, I don't know what's, you know, I've also got the note here, the eclipse on the 28th October will be really intense for him. There could be some big sudden changes that happen at that time as well. So it will be an interesting case study to watch, is what I do believe. But, you know, it's, yeah, when I look at this list of, and I'm not going to say who all these people are, but there are all these high profile YouTubers who are being taken down now for censorship reasons. And, you know, look at Dr. Berg. I mean, he's just telling people to eat vegetables. And what, you're going to censor him? I mean, what is the world coming to? And that is the thing that scares me. That's the thing that worries me. That, you know, I am worried about that. I am worried about that there are far too many rules on the planet. And, you know, we can't talk anymore. And that's a large scale problem. That's a really big thing. And it's sad to lose a voice, a person who's putting out content on the good side. It is always sad to lose that voice because then there aren't enough voices at that level, you know, who've got the millions of subscribers who are prepared to really talk. But Dr. Eric Berg, if you go and have a look at his, and maybe I'll be flagged because I've now mentioned Dr. Eric Berg. I don't know. See, and I've got a little drop in the bucket channel, you know, and I've got a tiny little channel here. And yet I worry about, you know, can I speak and things like that. It's, what kind of a world are we living in? That really does concern me. Because life is just becoming too much. Two rules heavy. And do we have astrology for that? We do. It's Pluto and Capricorn. You know, a lot of all of this is being dealt with now. And I do realize that this decade, and I've heard other future predictors, people who predict the future, even in finance and high quality channels and different people that I watch, you know, people are saying that, yeah, this decade's going to be tough still. And I do think so. A lot of people are predicting 2030 onwards, things will be a lot better. I do believe that. That's one thing that astrology has taught me for sure, that all the tough time periods, they come to an end. And when they come to an end, there really is a time period of reward that follows afterwards. So, you know, I'm not overly concerned, but yeah, it's... what a time, hey? And, you know, hopefully things will change sooner rather than later. But yeah, if there is anything interesting, I will keep you posted here on this channel. I'll do my best to talk about things. You know, I like to talk about something a bit interesting as well. I don't want to just talk about only safe subjects. I want to talk about what's interesting too, you know. I don't want to avoid what's happening in the world today. I think it's really important to speak about what's going on. So let's see what happens. All right, guys, well, what I'm going to do is we're going to take a look at the mini report. So this time I am going to concentrate on the movement of the faster moving planets. I'm wearing grey today in honor of Ketu because we're going to have a look at Mars stepping into, you know, I think it's Libra with Ketu, so we'll have a look at that. I'm not going to do the new moon and the full moon. That's going to be eclipses, so I will cover that in a separate breakout video. All right, let's take a look. Aries, welcome. So this is Aries ascendant, Aries moon, Aries sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, if you haven't had much forward momentum lately, it's okay. Let's see if that's going to happen when Venus steps into your fifth house. So if you haven't felt creative in a long time, that is set to change this month, okay? Look out for that natural feeling of, I want to be creative, I want to make something, I want to do something, I want to get on with something. You might find that natural motivation and momentum will come at the start of October. Now Mars steps into your seventh house with Ketu on the 4th of October. Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards, okay? So relationships have been suppressed in your life over the past year and a half. If you have felt that way, it's Ketu in your seventh house there in Libra. So that is a long time, but you know, you might have noticed that, yeah, for the last year and a half, you might have been single, for example, for that period of time. Or perhaps you haven't felt very social. Equally, if you're married or in a long-term partnership, you might have noticed that there has been tension, or maybe you've had to help your partner more, or maybe there's been less desire in the partnership or something like that. What you're going to find is this suppression energy is going to be lifted off at the end of November. So just hang in there, Aries. Now, there's a Pravartana exchange. By the way, that could also be self-employed business people. Might have also felt that they haven't been getting as many clients and things like that. So this could manifest in that way too. So that will lift off end of November. You should get more clients, more activity, more going on. Now, there's a Pravartana exchange happening between Venus and the Sun from 18th October to 3rd November. This is between your 5th and 7th houses. So this is lovely energy, actually. This is getting you ready to be more social in the coming months. Fun is back on the agenda, Aries. Thank you so much for joining. We are now going to welcome Taurus. Taurus, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Taurus Ascendant. Taurus Moon or Taurus Sun as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, if you haven't felt much forward momentum, Taurus, lately, see if you're going to experience that at the start of October. So we're going to have Venus step into your fourth house at the start of October. Now, a house-related issue could be sorted out at this time, or if there's been, like, maybe you've been needing to get repairs done on your home or something and it's been stalled or stuck or you haven't been able to, well, some house-related issue you'll be able to get forward momentum on. Or it could be something to do with your relationship with mother. Maybe, you know, you'll be interacting with her more or get more time with her or something along those lines. Now, Mars is going to step into your sixth house with Ketu on the 4th of October. Okay, so Mars is going to step into your sixth house. Ketu is there. This is happening on the 4th of October. Now, Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. So this is actually quite good energy here. This is like a good injection of energy into your career, definitely. If career has been slow or has been stuck, or you haven't been able to attract as many clients or this kind of thing, you might find that there is a burst of energy in here and things pick up, okay, in the month of October. But a really good thing is that if you've felt that your career has been quite suppressed, say over the past year and a half, this is going to lift and shift at the end of November when Rahu and Ketu shift. I will, of course, be covering that in a larger breakout video. Got here, you've got winning stars and energy to create progress this October, okay? So work with the energies as they are. It will be better, even better for you, I think, November onwards. But it's not too bad. I've got the note here, be careful of accruing debt this month. Mars and Jupiter are opposed, and that is happening on your... Yes, because we've got the sixth house there. So I'm really looking at that sixth house. So just take care about accruing debt this month. There is also a Parivartana exchange between Venus and the Sun from 18th October to 3rd November in your 4th and 6th houses. So this is a good time to use any earnings, extra earnings you have. This is a good time to pay off any debts, okay? But Taurus, thank you so much for joining. As for the moon situation, I will cover that in a separate breakout video, so look out for that. All right, we are now going to welcome Gemini. Gemini, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Gemini Ascendant, Gemini Moon, or Gemini Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Okay, now you can expect some forward momentum as Venus steps into your third house at the start of the month. Now, I am just going to check. I'm pretty sure that that is on the 2nd of October. Yes, it is. Sorry, I just had to check that for all signs because I'm just about to record all of these and I haven't got the date. So that is 2nd October. Thank you so much, Gemini, for bearing with me. All right, let's take a look. So, expect forward momentum as Venus steps into your third house, and that is on the 2nd of October. Oh, this is nice energy, Gemini. This is really, really good. You might feel more social. You might feel like going out. You might feel like having fun. Definitely do that. Okay, make sure you get out and about. Now, Mars steps into your fifth house with Ketu on the 4th of October. Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. So this could really put the focus on your children, and you might need to be a calm presence for them at this time, okay? The other thing is that expenses might run a bit higher this month, so just bear that in mind. Now, there's a parivartana exchange between Venus and the Sun from the 18th of October to the 3rd of November in your fifth and third houses, third and fifth houses, I should say, because that's Venus and the Sun. I've got the note here, if you're feeling an impulse to be creative, then definitely follow that impulse. But Gemini, it is looking good for you, especially that beautiful Venus energy there in the third house. That's nice social energy, so enjoy that. All right, thank you so much for tuning in. And we are now going to welcome Cancer. Cancer, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Cancer Ascendant, Cancer Moon, or Cancer Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. So now, on the 2nd of October, we've got Venus stepping into your second house. And I do believe this is going to bring a feeling of forward momentum. If you've felt that life has been really stuck or really stagnant, let's observe Venus and let's see if this is what's going to do it, because Venus is going to step into Leo and Venus will be in a drier place, Mars will be in a drier place. I do think that we're going to have some action, some forward momentum, you know, things will be feeling better again, hopefully, if things have been stuck for you. Now, where is this happening for you and what area of your life? Well, this is your second house of home. So I've got the note here, cook up something delicious, treat yourself in some simple way. All right, so definitely just enjoy a bit of me time. You know, if you wanted to treat yourself to some little purchase of something beautiful, you could do that as well. A bit of retail therapy. Now, I've got the note here, but don't go overboard with that, because there's probably some other planet that like wants you to save money right now. Everybody's in saving mode, so do the saving actually more than... I think definitely cook up something delicious. That's always good. Now Mars steps into the fourth house with Ketu, and that's on the 4th of October. And Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. So I've got the note here, this isn't the best time to move or do property-related things. Now, if you have to move because you've had that booked in for many months and this is the month that you're moving, don't worry, do move, but build in buffer time or take extra care, you know. The other thing is take care with your appliances and property-related things. Just use everything carefully, you know, because, yeah, you don't want anything... like if the energy surges or something breaks down or something stops working or something like that, that could be inconvenient. So just take care of property related things. Now, there is a Parivartana exchange between Venus and the Sun from the 18th of October to the 3rd of November in your second and fourth houses. So for this, I've got the note that this is nice energy for you to spend time at home or spend time with family, but equally, Mars is in the mix there. So you might also be feeling a bit of cabin fever or restless as well. So just see how you go with that. This could be a bit of a mixed month in terms of, you know, being at home and the comfort of that versus being a bit frustrated, wanting to go out, you know. And it's a good time with Mars as well to just be conscious of how you speak to your family members and things like that. That's just something to bear in mind there as well, Cancer. But I want to thank you so much for tuning in. And we are now going to welcome Leo. Leo, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Leo Ascendant, Leo Moon, or Leo Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, we've got Venus stepping into your first house in Leo. This is all about you, Leo, on the 2nd of October. So you might have the energy to pick up a fitness routine if you stopped doing a fitness routine. And I know that is definitely me. Over the last however many weeks, I have just not bothered to do my yoga at all. I did some yoga, I think this was like, was it last Saturday? And yeah, that it, I did, I don't know, you know, when you do those stomach crunches and then you feel like pain kind of thing. Yeah, it's been a while. So I need to get back into my fitness routine. And then I had this awful headache on Monday. I couldn't do anything. So I'll pick it up tomorrow. That's what I'm doing. But you might, if there's a fitness routine that you have dropped off, you can pick that up in October. Now, if you're not feeling it, if you still don't have energy, if you're tired, don't push it, okay? Go easy on yourself. As I said, I tried to pick mine up on the weekend, and then Monday I had this terrible headache, so yeah, I've had to stop it again. I'll get back there. It'll all happen. This is early. I'm recording this in September, so I've got time. All right, now you've got Mars stepping into your third house with Ketu on the 4th of October. So Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. So you've definitely got energy to get ahead at work now, to be seen, to promote yourself. Now, Ketu might have suppressed your confidence over the last 1.5 years. Ketu might have also suppressed Leo, a social media platform. If you have been working at social media and you look back over the last 1.5 years and you go, wow, my channel hasn't grown at all, this could be why, or your Instagram or whatever it is. Okay, so I know there's a lot of you who do social media out there, so yeah. What you're going to find is this suppression energy will lift end of November. I'll be covering that in the Raha Ketu video that I'm going to record quite soon. I just haven't got around to it yet. Now, there's a Parivartana exchange happening between Venus and the Sun from 18th October to the 3rd of November in your first and third houses. So Venus is giving you confidence this month. This is really nice energy. You will look good, you'll feel good, you'll eat healthy, you'll feel abundant. Okay, Venus energy is coming back into that third house. So you're getting a little preview of some shifts here, and this is really nice. Yeah, I've got here end of November, there will be a shift. Your confidence is going to go up. Okay, so Leo, I'm excited for you. This looks like a good month and some new things happening here for you. All right, we are now going to welcome Virgo. Virgo, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Virgo Ascendant, Virgo Moon, or Virgo Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, on the 2nd of October, we've got Venus stepping into your 12th house, and that's going to be stepping into Leo. You might feel like escaping from it all. You might feel some energy. You might feel some forward momentum. If you feel that life has been stuck or stagnant, you might feel that, you know what, things are starting to move again a little bit, right? and that's October, start of October onwards. But you get that energy and you just might feel like, I want to escape it all. I want to go somewhere. I want to have a little trip somewhere. Now, if that's possible for you to do and it makes sense for you to do, like if you happen to have spare money to do that and you can get a little trip somewhere, that could be a really nice thing to do with this Venus in your 12th house, even if it's just a little day trip somewhere, you know. Now, Mars steps into your second house with Ketu on the 4th of October. Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. So you might have felt suppressed by family relationships or a lack of ability to save money. And this is going to be the last couple of months of that. Okay, we're going to have Rahu Ketu shift end of November. So you don't have too much longer with things being suppressed in your second house. So that's suppressing family relationships or ability to save money. Got here, take care in your relationships with family. Mars is stepping into the second house there. So yeah, there could be tensions with family members. There could be aggression with family members, arguments with family members. That is possible here across October. So just take care of that. Got here, end of November, these suppression energies will lift off. Things will shift, things will change. Now, there's a Parivartana exchange happening between Venus and the Sun from the 18th of October to the 3rd of November in your 12th and 2nd houses. So Venus is providing some sweetness to your family relationships, which is really nice. You do have Mars there, but Venus is providing a little bit of sweetness there. So it could be a bit of a mixture, just see how that goes. But there could be some sweetness in your family relationships and or your financial situation. I've also got the note here, which is really interesting. Remember, sometimes we make more money by what we say no to. That's a really key point. That's very Venus. And with Venus, if you want to shift your baseline up, you do that by saying no to things, right? Knowing what to say no to. All right, Virgo, well, thank you so much for tuning in. We are now going to welcome Libra. Libra, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Libra Ascendant, Libra Moon, or Libra Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, on the 2nd of October, you can possibly expect some forward momentum as Venus steps into your 11th house, and that will be there in Leo. You might be feeling more social. This is definitely a good time to have fun with your friends. Now, Mars steps into your first house with Ketu on the 4th of October. Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. So physically, you might feel fluctuations in your energy. If you felt a little bit flat over a long time, like we're talking over the last year and a half or so, know that this is going to lift and shift at the end of November. Ketu might have been suppressing your physical energy, your physical body over this time. And as someone, you know, me, I've got my Ketu in my first house. And yeah, I tell you, energy is tough, hard to come by sometimes. Like, yeah, Ketu in the first house, person can struggle with energy. I certainly have. Over my whole lifetime. But that's all right, you know. It's there are other benefits to having Ketu in your first house. And you might look out for that, Libra. Have you become a little bit more psychic over the last year and a half? That's quite possible. So take a look at that. As a Parivartana exchange happening between Venus and the Sun from the 18th of October to the 3rd of November in your 11th and 1st houses. So Venus is feeling social here. This is really nice energy, and Venus will help you to look good, to feel great this month. This is a really good time to network or to put yourself out there for more work or more clients. And this could be good energy as well for social media. Venus in the 11th house, fantastic for social media. So if you're looking to start a channel or launch more content or any of that, this is a good month for that, Libra. All right, thank you so much for tuning in. We are now going to welcome Scorpio. Scorpio, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. This is Scorpio Ascendant, Scorpio Moon, or Scorpio Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. So now on the 2nd of October, you're going to have Venus stepping into your 10th house. That's in Leo. And what you might feel is that there's some forward momentum in your career. Okay, if you feel like things have been stuck career-wise, nothing's going on, why is it so stagnant? It could be Venus related. Keep your eyes peeled for that. See if October's the month where things start to get a little better there. Now, Mars steps into your 12th house with Ketu on the 4th of October. Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. So one of the things you might find is all this activity in your 12th house, it might be hard to sleep this month. And the other thing I also want to say is also be careful of acquiring debt this month, as Jupiter is opposed to Mars. Okay, so your expenses might be running higher, you might be tempted to pull out the credit card, you know, you might just want to think about that, maybe not spend the money, something like that. Parivartana exchange is going to be happening between Venus and the Sun from 18th October to 3rd November in your 10th and 12th houses. So this is actually, now this one's interesting, this is actually good energy for marketing. You know, if you have something that you need to sell or you need ideas, because we do have 12th house here. 12th house is, you know, it can be film and things like that and entertainment and things like that. So that's kind of why I'm looking at marketing energy. I've got here, you might get ideas on how to market yourself, your project, or what you do. Inspired work-related ideas of all kinds could come to you at this time. It's interesting energy here, Scorpio. I'm wishing you well. Thank you so much for tuning in. And we are now going to welcome Sagittarius. Sagittarius, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Sagittarius Ascendant, Sagittarius Moon, or Sagittarius Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, on the 2nd of October, you can expect some forward momentum as Venus steps into your 9th house. So this is really good energy for your relationships. It will last for about a month. Then you'll have another month where it's not the best energy for relationships. And then after that month, so after November, I do believe, when we go into December, you're going to have a long stretch with Venus where it's great energy for your relationships. Now Mars steps into the 11th house with Ketu on the 4th of October. Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. So this is good energy that can help you build and grow your network and or your gains. And at the end of November, any suppression energy that has been on your earnings or on your projects, this suppression energy will lift off. Okay, and this suppression energy could also have been blocking you from, let's say you were trying to build a social media platform, but maybe it was really slow growth. This could be why. Okay. Now when Ketu goes into your 10th, and we'll talk about that when we do the Rahu Ketu axis shift video, but that's also not the best for career either. But it's slightly different. Okay. Ketu in the 10th can actually be really good. Actually, if you're in a stable job that you love, Ketu in the 10th can keep that job in place. So we'll talk about that when we look at the Rahu Ketu axis video. Now there's a Parivartana exchange happening between Venus and the Sun from the 18th of October to the 3rd of November in your 9th and 11th houses. So this is a good little burst of energy here that will help you grow your network of friends or work colleagues. Could also help you grow your international contacts as well, because we've got Venus in the 9th house there. This could be also some kind of indicator. There could be some travel here for you as well, Sagittarius, or you're making travel plans this month. So that's some nice energy there. But I want to thank you so much for tuning in, and we are now going to welcome Capricorn. Capricorn, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Capricorn Ascendant, Capricorn Moon, or Capricorn Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, on the 2nd of October, you can expect some forward momentum as Venus steps into your 8th house. Now, relationship-wise, this is good energy, Capricorn. I'm so happy. This is much better energy here than what you've had over the last couple of months. You're just coming out of this quite difficult stretch here with Venus, okay? So there's some good energy here for you when it comes to Venus. Now, Mars steps into your 10th house with Ketu on the 4th of October. Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. So this is a burst of energy into your career, okay? This is good. If career has been tough over the last year and a half, then don't worry. Ketu is going to shift at the end of November, and I will cover that in the Rahu Ketu video that I'm going to be preparing soon. But you've got a lot of planetary energy here in the 10th house this month, and that's going to give you a nice new burst of energy. There's going to be some new energy here with career. This is good. This is something to look forward to. And it's all the great performers. You look at that, Mars, Sun, and Mercury in the 10th. That's really powerful. That's really good. So you're going to have a little, I think it's going to be like a little preview maybe as to how things will go next year, but we'll talk more about that in the Rahu Ketu shift video that I do. Now, there's a Parivartana exchange happening between Venus and the Sun from the 18th of October to the 3rd of November in your 8th and 10th houses. So you might get some insight into the hidden agendas that are going on at your workplace. Isn't that interesting? If there's some behind the scenes thing or something that's hidden or something that you haven't known about, or your intuition, and this is specifically to do with the workplace because this is a Parivartana exchange between 8th house and 10th house, you might be quite psychic or perceptive about something hidden at work. I don't know, there's just something that you figure out, or you're figuring out the hidden agendas behind things. This could also be to do with people, family members as well, but this is 10th house. This is specifically work. This is in a work context. So yeah, just see how you go with that. See if you end up being privy to something that you otherwise typically wouldn't be. It's quite interesting energy there, Capricorn. I'm wishing you well. Take care. And we are now going to welcome Aquarius. Aquarius, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. This is Aquarius Ascendant, Aquarius Moon, or Aquarius Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, I've got the note here, expect forward momentum as Venus steps into your 7th house. Venus is going to step into your 7th house. That's in Leo from the 2nd of October onwards. So this is really good, actually, if you run a social media channel. And mainly just for work, actually. I was just looking at relationships. No, this is not the best relationship energy here. You're going to have better relationship energy next month. Okay, so Aquarius, if relationships have been difficult for you, you know why. You've have been going through a little bit of a tough time with relationships lately. That will improve, though, next month. Now, Mars steps into your 9th house with Ketu on the 4th of October. Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. So what you might find across the month of October is that there could be conflicts with authority. This is a really good time to take care in your work relationships, your relationship with father as well. That could be tense at times, so you just want to bear that in mind. Also, relationship with cousins or brothers or, you know, siblings or any of that. But do take care in your relationships. Things could be a bit, hectic, but definitely conflicts of authority could be here across this time. Now, there's a Parivartana exchange between Venus and the Sun from the 18th of October to the 3rd of November in your 7th and 9th houses. This is good energy that will enhance your empathy and ability to navigate any authority conflicts. Yeah, Venus will help you out with this, but do take care. There could be some conflicts of authority at this time. Also got the note here, hang in there, Aquarius. You're going to have one of the best Rahu Ketu shifts for 1.5 years. That's going to come at the end of November. So do watch my my Rahu Ketu video. That is coming soon. Aquarius, I want to thank you so much for tuning in. And we are now going to welcome Pisces. Pisces, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. This is Pisces Ascendant, Pisces Moon, or Pisces Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. I'm just checking the time. It will time out in a moment. But that's okay. I'll just keep going. Now, on the 2nd of October, we are going to have Venus step into your sixth house in Leo. This is really good energy for your service to the world, for your work, for your career, for what you do. Okay. If you found that work or life has been quite stagnant lately, I think you might find start of October, there's going to be some movement coming into life again. It should be good. It should be better. Now, Mars steps into your eighth house with Ketu on the 4th of October. So Mars will be joined by the Sun and Mercury mid-month onwards. There could be shifts and changes in how you work, in where you work, or the way that you work. Something to do with work could really shift and transform here. There could also be shifts and changes in shared assets, or within your family, your greater family, your in-laws. There could be some shifts and changes there. There's a Parivartana exchange happening between Venus and the Sun from the 18th of October to the 3rd of November in your 6th and 8th houses. This is really significant. Not only is it a Parivartana exchange, but it's also a Viparita Raj Yoga. And if there is something quite difficult, I've also got the note here, yeah, this is a Viparita Raj Yoga. If there is something quite difficult in your life, face it with courage. And you really might overcome it so incredibly well that there is some kind of huge reward for your courage, for you facing this challenge. I've got the note here, move through the fear. Recognize that fear is just an illusion. So, Pisces, and anyone who stayed till the end and has watched the whole video, I want to thank you so much for tuning in. Let me know how you get on in the comments below. I love reading your comments, guys. I used to reply to comments and things like that. These days I don't have time and energy to do that. But I really love reading the comments. They're always so encouraging and they motivate me to keep going. So I really want to thank you so much for letting me know how you get on with these and what matches up and what doesn't and what's working and what's not. I love reading all that. It's so good. And I learn a lot from the comments. You know, there's so many comments that that feed into my work as well. So the comment section is really important to me. But I want to thank you all for tuning in and I look forward to seeing you next time.